Hello? Assalamu alaikum. Well, now that's more like it. I like this. This is looking good. You guys are all attentive and ready to go, mashallah. And this good behavior encourages me, makes me want to sit with you and talk to you even more about our subject, about prophets. Do you remember we were talking about prophets, right?
Yes.
And we were talking about prophet came with a message. Yeah?
Yeah.
Who remembers the message?
La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah.
That's exactly right. La ilaha illallah. There's no God to worship except one God, right? But the problem comes in that not everybody tells the truth. Some people tell the truth and some people don't tell the truth. So if a prophet comes to us and tells us anything, we should believe them. But what if somebody comes to us, says they're a prophet, but they're really not a prophet? Uh-oh. Now we'd have a problem, right? So how would we find out? Well, we have to use our head. You can use your brain, right? Now if somebody came to your house, knocking on the door, and they said, I want to come in your house. Would you just open the door and let them come in? You don't even know who they are? Would you? No. You would say, who are you? Yeah? And then maybe they would say, I work for the telephone company and I want to look at your telephone. Would you now open the door and just let them walk in?
No.
Not yet. Okay, especially if you look around your house and you discover you don't even have a telephone. Who is this guy, right? Why should I let this guy come in the door? He said, I'm with the telephone company. We'll ask him for what? Proof. Can we ask him for proof? Yeah. Can you prove who you are? He said, of course I can. So, okay, tell us, how will I know? He said, well, because telephone company doesn't lie, right? I work for the telephone company, therefore I can't lie, so let me in your house. You let him in now?
No.
Now he's sounding even worse, doesn't he? He said, look, if you have some proof, maybe we'll think about it. What proof do you have? And then if he said, well, I have my ID. I have some, you know, photograph and information about me on a card. It shows I work for the phone company. Now will you let him in?
No.
Wait a minute. I want to see it. He said he had it, but I didn't see it yet. I want to see it, okay? He said, okay. But I don't have it with me. I'll bring it later. No, I want to see your proof. Give us the proof so we can see who you are. Make sense? Now, if he brings a picture, an ID, and it says he works at the phone company, maybe he's telling the truth. But it should also be a phone number. And we'll call and check and see if he really is the right person. Make sense? But if we look, we said, oh, but there's no phone number on here. He said, oh, we don't have a phone. How are you working for the phone company and you don't have a telephone? Duh. Okay, hold on a second. Let's think about this. If he's really who he says he is, there should be some way we could prove it. Otherwise, I'm not going to open the door. Make sense? All right, now, using what we just talked about, letting somebody in our door, what about a prophet? Because if somebody comes to tell me about something that I can't see, like Jannah or Jahannam. Somebody's telling me about paradise. Somebody's trying to tell me about hellfire. Somebody's telling me there's a God. Somebody's saying things about Bibles or Qurans, things like that. But how do I know if I can believe this guy? I need to find more proof, yes? But what proof would I have? What would be his identification? How can I verify? I just want to be sure because I don't know. So what kind of proof would a prophet have to have? Now, if he just pulled out a piece of paper, has his picture on there and said, this is Prophet George, or this is Prophet Bill, or Prophet Betty, or Sarah, is that okay?
No.
No, I don't think so. Especially if I look at it, I think you just made that up in the parking lot. I think you just did that. So how will I know? Well, if they really came from God, if there really is a God, and they really came from God, then the proof that they have should be something only God could do. Make sense? So let's give an example about that. Let me think. How about Musa? You know who Musa is? Moses? Okay. Musa, alayhi salam, peace be upon him. Remember, we're going to say this about all the prophets. We're going to say, alayhi salam, peace be upon him, right? So, Musa, or Moses, he had some miracles that came with him. Because he went to Pharaoh. You know, Pharaoh was like the king of Egypt or something like that. And Pharaoh, he was telling people that he's the Lord. He wants people basically to pray to him, worship him. It was really bad. And he used to kill people just for fun, something to do in the afternoon. Are you busy? No, let's go kill some people. You know, he didn't care. So this is the kind of man he was, really bad. Now Musa, alayhi salam, went to him and was telling him, you know what? I am the prophet of Allah. I am a messenger of Allah. And I'm here for my people. Let them go. Because, see, Pharaoh had the people of Moses trapped, making them work like slaves. Horrible. So the Pharaoh, he said, nah, you're no problem. Get out of here. Besides, he wants people to pray to him. If you say that there's another God, well, that doesn't work for Pharaoh anyway. So what happened? Well, to prove it, God sent miracles with Musa, alayhi salam. Let me give you some examples of what happened. When Pharaoh rejected the message, he said, nah, I don't need that. So Allah made things happen. Well, you know what one of the things that happened? Bugs. Ugly, nasty bugs. You know, insects? They just came all over, everywhere. And they were destroying everything. And they wouldn't go away until Pharaoh said, okay, okay, okay. But after he did that, the bugs went away. But then he said, never mind, change my mind. And Allah brought another one on him. One time Allah made all the ground dry, and there was no water for the people to drink. And he said, okay, 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 okay. And then Allah made the water come, and guess what? He said, nah, nah, I'm still not going to let them go. He still didn't want to believe. Now Moses, had a helper. Even his helper was his brother named Harun. His own brother said, yes, he's really a prophet. This is the prophet. He said, so I still don't believe you. You know what? He doesn't want to accept the signs. Clear proof. Many signs. We've talked about the locusts. There's mention of frogs. A whole bunch of frogs. That'd be pretty gross, wouldn't it? Ugh. So many things came. Ew. Even the water turned into blood. Not only they don't have water, now what they do have turns into blood. It's running like blood. Nobody could drink it. And he said, okay, 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 yeah, all right, you can go. But as soon as Allah made it stop and come back to normal, again, look what this guy does. He's bad. Now, another thing that Pharaoh did, he had magicians. Now, these magicians used to come and trick the people to think that Pharaoh has some power. So they would take things like sticks and things like that, throw them out, and make these sticks, through their little trickery, look like snakes, moving around, twitching on the ground, and the people would be like, whoa, you know, but it was just tricks. So Pharaoh is going to bring his magicians with their tricks. But Musa, alayhi salam, was sent by Allah, and Allah told him what to do. What should he do? Allah told him, take your stick. Now he had what's called asa, stick. Yeah. And Allah told him, take your stick and throw it down, and it's going to become what?
Snake.
Exactly right. And then he said, Allah told him,
stretch out your hand to get your stick, and the snake's going to turn back to a stick. It'll be okay. Don't be afraid. It'll be all right. So when they came, the magicians said, who should go first? And actually they said, who should throw first? Should the magicians throw their thing or should Musa? Musa told them, go ahead. You go ahead. Throw your thing. And they did. They threw their sticks out there, and the little, probably had strings or something with it, you know, something stupid. But the people were going, oh, 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 look, 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 the little sticks are becoming sticks. And then Musa, alayhi salam, threw down his stick, only became a giant, real snake. And the snake ate up all of those fake snakes. And then when Musa Islam stretched out his hand, the snake turned back to a stick, and he picked it up. And look, it's just a stick. Now the magicians were looking like, uh-oh, excuse me, where's my little magic trick? This must be, oh my God, there really is a God. There really is a law, and Moses is the messenger. And right away they did what people do when they recognize that there really is Allah. They put their head on the ground and they bow down to Allah. And that's what they did. Now, all the time Pharaoh is watching this stuff. He's on a big throne, you know, like, hey, what's up with that, you know? And then when he saw his magicians bowing down and they said, we believe in the God of Moses. We believe in the God of Moses. You know, Pharaoh's going, these guys, yep, they made a deal with Moses and they're just tricking me. That's it. You guys, you sold me out. That's it. I'm going to have you drawn and quartered. I'm going to have them beat you. They're going to cut your leg, cut your arm. I'm going to have to do all it. And you know what they said? We don't really care. We don't care what you do because you're not Allah. We only believe in Allah. So do what you do. Is that amazing? Wow. And that's not the only prophet that had signs. And that's not the only signs that Moses had. But that's sure a pretty good one, isn't it? Imagine a stick turns into what? Snake? And eats up their little magic? Do you know that when Moses, alayhi salam, peace be upon him, was taking the children of Israel away from Pharaoh, because they got away, they escaped, and they were going like, let's go, you know, and they were bringing all their goodies and stuff that they had from Egypt, and they had lots of stuff, man, lots of stuff, and they were going, let's get out of here, and they went, and they went, and they went, and then they came up to the, what's called the Red Sea, it's Bahar, big sea. Now, this sea is so big, I've been there, by the way. And I looked across as far as I could see, and you know what? I couldn't see the other side. That's how big it is. It's not like a river. No, it's not like this little pond. No. It's so big. You look, and you can't see the other side. I even got in a boat, and we went, and we went, and we went half of the day. We still couldn't see the other side. So it's big. Now, when they got to the water, and they were up against the water like this, they realized Pharaoh changed his mind. And here Pharaoh came with all of his army, and these guys are not just some people going out for a picnic, you know what I mean? They were having their weapons and everything, and they were coming right at the poor children of Israel. And here they're trapped right up against the water. And you know what? Instead of saying, oh, Allah help us, you know what they did? They got mad and they blamed Moses. Yeah. They said, look at you, you brought us out to this mess. Oh, we didn't want to do that. So what happened? Allah made something amazing happen. And he told Moses, stretch out your stick. Same stick, asa. Remember the asa? Yeah. Stretch it out, and then he popped the top of the water. Guess what happened? The water opened up. Yeah, it is still opened up. It opened up so wide and so far apart that all the people could walk through and not even get their feet wet. Now, how can this happen? Could this happen? No, this is not possible. I don't believe any person can do such a thing, even no matter how much equipment you have, You're not going to take the Red Sea and just go shh, shh. Go ahead, take a walk. Can't happen. It's not going to happen. So only Allah can do it. You're right. But Allah did it. And it was a big proof to the children of Israel, and it was a big proof to Pharaoh. Children of Israel went in and they followed Moses. I'm sure they must have been a little bit scared. What do you think? Would you be afraid? I would be afraid. With water up, way up like that, water way up like that. But they went through. And as they were going through, Pharaoh went in after them. Now I'm sure somebody with Pharaoh was going, hey, are you stupid? What are you doing? But he's like, go! So they were going, you know. But guys, can you imagine somebody with Pharaoh? But guys, you know, look at this. This is not real. This is something weird. What's going on? And then what happened? Well, the children of Israel got on the other side. They were safe. No problem. But what happened to Pharaoh? Well, Allah closed the water in on them.
And that's it. I'm getting between Allah closed the water.
Exactly. Exactly. And guess what happened? Not quite. Not quite. He was drowning, and he was saying, okay, now I believe in the God of Moses. Now he's going to say it. Now, but he said that before. But every time he did it, he lied. Because as soon as the difficulty went away, he went back to his disbelief and saying that he was a God, right? So what happened? A big miracle. The water opened up, it went through, came on him. He said, I believe in the God of Moses. Now the angels see this guy. They know he's a bad dude, right? Well, they didn't like that. So what do they want to do? They want to shut him up. And they're going to put hand over his mouth so he can't say it. But it doesn't matter to Allah. Because Allah knows what's in the heart. It doesn't matter just you say something with your mouth, does it? Now look what Allah said. Allah said in the Quran that he is going to preserve this Pharaoh, preserve him in his body, as a sign. And here we are in these days, an amazing sign has come true. Because you see, some years ago, there was a scientist who lived in France, and they asked him to come to Egypt to examine Pharaoh's body. Now, there were many pharaohs, but when they examined this body and they opened it up and they looked in, he said, this person died from drowning. This person died from what? Drowning. He said, this must be the real Pharaoh from the time of Moses. Ah, I can't believe it. Now remember, this is a man who is a scientist. This is a man who is a very smart person. And he said, this must be the man who drowned, which is Pharaoh. And guess what? His body is preserved. Yes or no? Yeah, it's right there. Only this happened thousands of years ago. And guess what else happened? They took the body of this Pharaoh and put it in a real fancy looking, you know, display, and they took it all around the world. I saw it in Chicago. The same guy, Pharaoh himself, and I saw him. How? All dried up, mummified, big holes where his eyes ought to be, but that was him. And they said he drowned. Amazing. Would you consider that a proof? I saw the guy. And I looked at him and I thought, wow, that's amazing, isn't it? So Allah said in the Quran that he had talked about Moses from before, and said, I'm going to preserve him. So when did this Quran come? Long time after Moses, and long before they discovered Pharaoh. So there's the proof, yes? It's only one of the many, many proofs that Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is one of the messengers of Allah. In fact, he's the last and the final messenger, but we're going to talk more about that later. All I want to talk about in this session that we're having now is this beautiful subject of proof. What is the proof? And so we look to other things for proof too. Now I want to mention something to you about some other prophets, because our subject only being proof, so it doesn't really matter which prophet we talk about. But I grew up as a Christian, and I knew a lot about Jesus. Peace be upon him. And I love Jesus very, very much, because all Muslims love Jesus. He's very special. One of the miracles that came with Jesus, you know what it was? From the very beginning, because he had no father, and he was a miracle. And his mother is the best woman that Allah created. That's what Allah said in the Quran. And then, from her, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made Jesus. And Allah calls him Isa ibn Maryam, which means Jesus, the son of Maryam, or Mary. They say Mary today, but Maryam was really the name for her. It's amazing. Amazing because there's no father. There's no husband. There's no man involved. Now check this out. Let's back up a second. Back up. A woman can't have a baby and she didn't see any man at all. It's impossible. So how this happened? Because it's a miracle. Now, she was a very good girl. She was the best girl. In fact, she was so good that she lived a special life in a special place. And it was that they used to check on her, and she was very, like, religious, very sweet, praying to Allah. And they would be amazed because all of a sudden food would be there. And it was food that was out of season. Delicious bananas or mangoes, oranges, lemons, many things that they said, well, this is not the season for that. How is she having all this food? Because how? The angels, I guess, bringing it to her, huh? And then, when she meets Jibril, who is Jibril? You remember?
Angel.
Angel? Right. Angel of Allah. Jibril, or Gabriel as they call him, is there. And he's talking to her, and she's saying, who are you? Stay back away from me. Fear Allah. Get away from me. Who are you? And he said, I'm an angel from Allah. I'm Jibril. I'm the Ruh, the spirit who's come from Allah. And he began to tell her she's going to have a baby. She said, how is that going to happen? No man has ever touched me. He said, even though, whenever Allah wants something to happen, what will happen? It's going to happen. Allah just says, kun fayakun. Be, and it is. Exactly. It's easy for Allah. Now I want you to think about something. This is a miracle. And even today, all the Muslims say so, and all the Christians say so, that it's a miracle birth of Jesus. But have you thought about this? How about Eve? Eve. Huh? How was she born? Hawa. You remember Hawa, the story of Hawa? We talked about her. How did she come about? Because Allah took her out of the rib, a bone, from who? Adam. How? How did Allah take a bone out of Adam and make it become a woman? I think that's a pretty big miracle too, do you? Yeah. And wait a minute. What about Adam? How did Allah make Adam? Didn't he make him from dirt? Clay? Yeah. How? Because Allah says, kun fayakun. So the creation of Adam, the creation of his wife, the creation of Jesus is all the same to Allah. Kun fayakun. Be. And it is. And that brings us to a wind up on our program right now, because we're going to wind down with that. We're going to give a big salam to everybody, and we ask for Allah's peace to be with all of those who seek truth. Amen.
Amen.
If you're looking for a book to read that's gonna give you what you need, the Quran is like a light. The readers, they shine so bright. It shows us the way to go. Before it, we did not know. When you put it in your heart, I think you're gonna say,
I love the Quran.
First you gotta read it, then you understand it, then you wanna say,
I love the Quran.
When you understand it, then you gotta do it, then you wanna say,
I love the Quran.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Peace be unto you all. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you all, my dear viewers, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless our guests here in the studio. Welcome to the second episode of your program, Quran for Kids. Quran is actually for all. Quran was sent to the entire humanity for guidance, for reflection, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the guidance through the Quran. Ameen. Today we will start the second episode. We didn't finish Suratul Fatiha last time. Inshallah, we get the chance to go over the rest of it today, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. And I do have with me here in the studio our beautiful guests in here. From my right, can you introduce yourself, please?
Abdulaziz Ibrahim
Zidan. Mashallah. Where he was born? Where?
In Cleveland.
He was born in Cleveland, Ohio, right? Okay, and how old are you?
11 years old.
He's 11. I guess you're getting to the 7th grade?
Yes.
Beautiful, Abdulaziz. What surah you are in right now?
Surat Yunus.
Surat Yunus. So you know like 18 juz, right? Yes. MashaAllah. May Allah bless him. Say Ameen.
Yeah.
May Allah bless you, Abdulaziz. And right next to him is, what's your name?
Noor.
Noor. Beautiful Noor, MashaAllah. Do you know what is the meaning of Noor?
Yeah.
What?
I know.
Is it light?
Yes.
It is light. Quran is Noor. And you are Noor, right? MashaAllah. And right next to Noor is?
Abdullah.
And how old are you, Abdullah?
I'm 8 years old.
You are 8. Which grade you are getting into?
Fourth
grade. Okay. And last time we said your surah is?
Surah Taha,
almost getting to half of the Quran, mashallah. Very proud of you guys, mashallah. And right next to him is the princess. What's your name?
Huda.
Huda. And how many surahs do you know, Huda? How many juz do you know? Sorry.
Five
juz. What's your surah?
Surah Al-Dukhan.
Al-Dukhan, you got it right this time. Okay, and how old are you again?
7.
Beautiful. Huda, mashallah. May Allah bless you. Say Ameen, guys.
Ameen.
Ameen. And right next to her is?
Muhammad.
Muhammad Dabour, right?
Yes.
And how old are you, Sheikh Muhammad?
11.
What's your surah again? Remind us.
Suratul
An'am. Suratul An'am, mashallah. He's almost finishing the Quran. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless him. Noor, before we start, what do you want?
My mother, one day I was...
We're going to get to that. Sorry for interruption. We'll get to all the questions. I thought you're going to add something about yourself. Is it okay? All right. Beautiful. So we're going to continue, inshallah, with Suratul Fatiha. We are going to go over it quickly. I will read. You read after me. And then we pinch in from where we stopped last time. All right? Okay?
Okay.
Let's start. I will start reading and then you say after me. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
الحمد لله رب العالمين. Straight up.
الحمد لله رب العالمين.
الرحمن الرحيم.
الرحمن الرحيم.
مالك يوم الدين.
مالك يوم الدين.
إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين.
إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين.
اهدنا الصراط المستقيم.
اهدنا الصراط المستقيم
صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم
صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم
غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. Everybody.
غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين.
Very good. And then as we said, Ameen is not part of the surah. We do say Ameen when the imam, if we are praying behind an imam, and he does say waladdallin, then we say Ameen. We learned together last time that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala started his book by saying Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, in the name of Allah, the most gracious, the most merciful. And we said, what is the meaning of ar-Rahman? Merciful to?
Everybody.
To everybody. He is merciful to everybody. And then ar-Rahim, he is especially merciful to?
Believers.
The believers. And then he say, Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, which means all thanks and all praise belong to whom?
Allah.
To Allah. Why?
Because he's the Lord.
He's the Lord.
He's the Lord. And he, what does it mean? He's the Lord. And he's the Rabb Al Alameen.
He's the master of everything.
Yes, but why do we thank him? Why would you thank somebody? Why would you thank somebody?
Created everything.
Yeah, because he does everything. Abdullah, why would you thank somebody?
Because he gave us blessings.
When he gives you something, right? This is when you give somebody, when you thank somebody, if he does you a favor, right? If I, as we said last time, if I give you something, you're going to be thanking me. You say thank you, right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who gave us everything. Now we say all thanks are for you, Allah, because you gave us everything. Alhamdulillah. All thanks and all praise belong to whom?
Allah.
Allah. Who is Allah? Rabbil Alameen. The Lord of the worlds. He is Rabb, the one who takes care of everything in the world. Whatever we see, whatever we do not see, He is the one that maintains everything, that takes care of everything. Right?
Yes.
Even our bodies, our hearts, we do not take care of that. We do not know. I don't know how my heart works. You know, so it pumps the blood day and night. It beats up day and night. I don't know how it works. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who is what? Who is taking care of that. Your mind works, Abdullah, right? You are thinking of something right now. Some ideas, I believe like 50 ideas every minute or something crosses the mind of, you know, average person. So all of these things, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who is controlling the mind. And the one who creates who created the brain of every single person, where, you know, it works in such an amazing way. He is Rabbil Alameen, the one that takes care of everything, the one that is holding everything in place of everybody. Noor, you got something for us? Go ahead, please. I like your amazing stories, by the way.
Can I check my jacket's here?
I guess it's cold for you. Can we take the AC down for her, please? We're going to get to that in the next episode, inshallah. It's kind of cold because the air condition is, you know, is needed for us. This is something that we need to exist. If it's too hot for us, you know, we feel uncomfortable, right? If it's too cold for us, like where Abdulaziz came from or was born in Cleveland, I guess it snows a lot in there in the winter, right? So you can't go out in the you know, middle of the night without a jacket or something. We need some jacket. We need some, you know, special conditions for us to live. If it's too cold, too hot, it's going to be hard, like it is right now for her. And I'm sorry for that. So, but for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He does not need, you know, a little more, you know, the air condition to go up or down. He doesn't need any of that. He exists without nothing of these, right? Because He is Allah and He is Al-Qayyum and He is the God and He is the Lord that exists with no need for anything. Because He is Rabbul Alameen. Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. All the thanks and the praise belong to Allah, the Lord of the worlds. Ar-Rahman, the most compassionate, the most merciful. We already talked about these. Maliki Yawmiddin. What is the next ayah again? Let's say it. Abdullah, can you say this ayah in a beautiful voice for us?
مالك يوم الدين.
One more time.
مالك يوم الدين.
Noor, can you say that? Go ahead.
مالك يوم الدين.
We say مالك يوم الدين. مالك. Can you say it? مالك يوم الدين. Go ahead.
مالك يوم الدين.
That's beautiful, isn't it? I like that. MashaAllah. Allah is Maliki. Probably all of us know what is the meaning of Malik. What's Malik?
King.
King.
A king. A Malik. A Malik is everything is under him. He owns everything. Or he is in top of everybody. Everybody is under him. This is Malik, right? And then we have Malik, the owner of everything. A king could be there, right? But he does not necessarily own my house. My house is in the kingdom of this king, but it's mine. Allah is Malik. He is also a king. He is a king, Malik and Malik. And both of them are right, by the way. Both of them are Quran. Maliki Yawmiddin and Maliki Yawmiddin. But probably all of us or most of us knows it and learns it like Maliki Yawmiddin. I will get to all of your questions, but just give me a few seconds to get this point across. So Allah is what? Is Maliki Yawmiddin. We know Him as the Lord of the worlds. And we knew Him as Ar-Rahman, the compassionate. And we knew Him as Ar-Rahim, the merciful. And now we know Him and He introduces Himself as what?
Maliki
Yawm al-Din. What does it mean? Maliki, the owner. He is the owner. The owner of what?
The
owner of
the last day.
Yawm al-Din, the day of judgment. The day of Hisab. The day where everybody will be brought for what?
To be judged.
To be judged. Like now, you are free. You can do whatever you want. You can say whatever you want. Right? You can be good to others, you can be bad to others. You can say good things, you can say bad things.
I wish I can have a babysitter.
A babysitter?
Sister.
Inshallah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because He is the giver and the one who gives everybody whatever they want, inshallah we make dua that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives you a baby sister, inshallah. You need to talk to your mom and dad about that, and then we make a lot of dua for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give you that. Inshallah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can give you anything we want. We have to ask Allah first, because He is what? Maliki. He is the owner, not only of the Day of Judgment. He is the owner of this life as well. Everything that we have belongs to Him. Mulku as-samawati wal-ard, the kingdom of the skies, heavens and earth, all belong to Him, right?
Yes.
Inna lillah, we belong to Allah. Right?
Yeah.
Do we?
Yes.
Like, what year? What year you were born, Abdullah?
2007.
2007, right? Before 2007. Let's say 2004. Where are you? I'm your dad, by the way, right? So you were not there? I did not know. I am your dad. I did not know you would be there. Nobody on the face of earth ever knew you would be there.
Except
right? Am I right? Only yeah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Before the date of your birth, nobody knew you would be there. Allah knew. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows everything. He is the one that knows everything because He owns everything. It's Him. It's His. Everything is His. Mulku as-samawati wal-ard. So He is Maliki, the owner of what? Yawm al-Din, the day of judgment. Now it might not be as clear that He is Malik. Because yeah, that shirt is what? Is it yours?
Yeah.
Is it yours?
No, it's yours.
Yes, it's mine. It's not yours. See, it's mine. I can show you that it's mine. I own it, right? But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, in the day of judgment, even your shirt, even the way you talk, nothing is going to belong to you. Only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nobody can even talk without His permission. It's going to be so clear that everything is His, because He is Maliki Yawm al-Din. We're going to take a quick break and come back, inshallah, to your questions and continue with Suratul Fatiha.
If you're looking for a book to read that's going to give you what you need, the Quran is like a light, the readers, they shine so bright. If you're looking for a book to read that's going to give you what you need, the Quran is like a light, the readers, they shine so bright.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Welcome back, my dear viewers, to your beautiful program of Quran for kids, and with the surah, the beautiful surah of Suratul Fatiha, the best surah in the Quran, inshallah. Hopefully we're going to continue and finish it, this segment, inshallah. and with our beautiful guests here in the studio, Abdul Aziz, Noor, Abdullah, Huda, and Muhammad. So we pinch up from where we stopped last time, and we were talking about what? Which ayah?
Maliki Yawm
al-Din, the owner of the day of judgment. He owns everything, but it's going to be so clear on the day of judgment that he is really the owner, because nobody can move right or left or even talk. يَوْمَ يَأْتِ لَا تَكَلَّمُ نَفْسٌ إِلَّا بِإِذْنِهِ. The day it will come, which is the day of judgment, no soul will talk except by his permission. فَلَا تَسْمَعُ إِلَّا هَمْسَ. You will not hear nothing but hamsa, very slight, faint, you know, talk. So nobody can even talk except by his permission, subhanahu wa ta'ala, because he is مَالِكِ يَوْمِ الدِّينِ. What is the next ayah?
إياك
عبدالله
إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين.
Recite it in a good voice.
إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين.
إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين. Right, Noor? So what does it mean? What does it mean? إياك, you alone. When you say you, أنت, that means you, just you. Could be others, you and her and him and others. But when you say Iyaka, Muhammad, when you say Iyaka, that means you alone. You alone, O Allah, do we worship. Iyaka na'bud, we worship Allah. What does worship means? We worship means you obey and listen completely without discussion, only for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You go after him without questioning what he says, because you believe in him, right? If you believe in somebody who guides you, who drives a car, or he guides the tour for you, you believe in him, then you go after him. You believe in your mom and dad that they will take care of you, they do everything good for you, you just go with them and you don't question what do they do. Our ultimate faith and belief is in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why we go after him without ever questioning what he might say or want from us subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it means to do everything that he likes and approves of without questioning that, out of love for him and out of submission for him. That is the meaning of ibadah. You listen to him. You listen to him. That's worship. وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ. And you alone do we worship. So do we seek for help or ask for help. We worship Allah. We listen to Allah, in other words. And we ask help from him, because it's going to be only through the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that you're going to be a good person, that you're going to be a good worshipper. You worship him, you listen to him, right? It might not be because we have some desires. You know, my nafs, my soul wants to do this, but Allah doesn't want me to do that. I want to have everything to be mine. You know, we're talking about my shirt a few minutes ago, and he said mine. He didn't mean it, but sometimes you know, it's mine. You and your friend or something, you are, you know, disagreeing about something, and you say, mine, mine, mine. You want it to be yours, right? You disagree with him about something. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for you to listen to him all the time, you're going to need some help. And that help comes only from him. Before I move on from here, there is a beautiful hadith. What is a hadith, by the way? What is a hadith? Huda?
It's like something the Prophet Muhammad gave it to us.
Something that the Prophet Muhammad gave it to us, right? He did say something to us, he did do something for us, or he, you know, gives us approved of something. Like anything that comes to us from Prophet Muhammad is basically like a hadith, right? So a beautiful hadith, which is like the Prophet is talking to us, he was talking about this surah, Suratul Fatiha, and he said, when you say Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, it's like a conversation between you and Allah when you get to the salah. It's like a conversation, it's like a dialogue. You say, oh Allah, thank you. All thanks belong to you. Do you know what? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would say, My servant has thanked me. Now you say, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would say, my servant has praised me. And then you say, Maliki Yawmiddin, the owner of the day of judgment. Allah would say, my servant has really now again praised me again. And you say, إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ, which means, I worship you, Allah, and I ask help from you, O Allah. Then Allah would say, subhanahu wa ta'ala, that this is between me and my servant. I am the only one who knows if he does worship me the right way, and he does seek help only of me. That's something only Allah knows about it, right? And now he said, go ahead, my servant, whatever you ask, I'm going to give it to you. After you, this is like the good beginning in there. You say, when you get to a king or something, you praise him first, your excellence, this and that. So you say, oh Allah, all thanks and all praise belong to you. You are the compassionate, the most merciful. You are the owner of the day of judgment. And then you say, I worship you alone, and I ask help of you alone. Then you ask, you start asking of him. This is the king. Now you can ask him, Abdullah.
When you say Allah is Malik Yawm al-Din and he does not have any need, he is not need for anything, then if he's not need for anything, why does he ask the Malaika to do stuff if he can do it himself?
Well, this is a beautiful question. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has a will. What is a will? Like he wants to do something, right? Right, so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has the will, he wants to do anything, he doesn't need anybody to execute this will, to do this. All he needs, actually he doesn't need that, it's just for the execution of that will, is that for him to say, kun, be, and what happens? It is. He said, you sky, rain, it rains. You Abdullah, be. And you be, you come to existence. It doesn't need anything. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put some angels, for example, to execute, to be responsible for the execution. Do you know what is an execution? To implement, to do this. You, this king, will take care of the Quran, being the messenger between Allah and his messengers. Which king is that?
Jibril.
Jibril alayhi salam, between Allah and his messengers. Another king will take care of, you know, when somebody dies, he takes the soul of that person and give it back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala somehow. Which angel is that?
Israfil.
Malakul Maut, the death angel, right? And we have some angels who kiram and katibin, they record everything we say and we do, right? So those are angels, kiram and katibin. We have some angels who carry the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَيَحْمِلُ عَرْشَ رَبِّكَ فَوْقَهُمْ يَوْمَئِذٍ ثَمَانِيَ. How many of them are there? Eight of them, that they carry the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a way that fits His Majesty subhanahu wa ta'ala. So angels are not really, really needed, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for the system, to have a system, this is His will subhanahu wa ta'ala, that angels will be there to execute those things and do different tasks for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Let's continue with Surah Al-Fatiha quickly, and then I'm going to take your questions later. إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ. Now it's time, after we praise Allah, thank Allah, being the Lord of the world, the merciful, the owner of the day of judgment, and all of these, we start asking of Him. What do we ask of Him? Guidance. إِهْدِنَا. Oh Allah, guide us. If you're not guided, you're going to go left, right. If you're coming from point A to point B, and you don't know the way, you're probably going to end up in C, from A to C, from A to Z, any other point that you didn't really mean it, because you do not know the way from A to B. It's only when you know the way from A to B, not only that you know it, you might know the way from point A to point B, but then you decide not to go this way. Even though you know this is the right way, you decide to go from A to C. Even though you know that this is the right way to take you to B, are you going to end up being in B when you take the way to C? No, it's not gonna. So two things are there. You have to know which way that takes you from A to B, and you have to go ahead and adopt and follow this way. Both of these things are needed for us to make it through, all the way through to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to Jannah. What are the 2 points again? We have to know which way to go. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala helps us, and He's telling us in here, this is the way to go. Read the Quran. I'm telling you, this is right, do it. This is wrong, don't do it. He is telling us the way. Now we know it. We need, what do we need? What do we still need for us to go from A to B? From here, dunya, to al-akhirah, to the hereafter, to Jannah. Now we know that Allah wants us to be good, to be kind, to do all good things. We need to do what? To do these things and adopt and take this way. Am I right?
Yes.
Yes. So we need to know what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us, and we need to do it and implement it. That is the meaning of ihdina as-sirat al-mustaqim. Guide us the straight path. Path that takes us to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Path is a way. The way that takes you to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Abdullah?
What if someone gets guided the wrong way and doesn't have a chance to get guided the right way?
Gets guided the wrong way, which is misguided. In the way, there are some, could be people, could be shayateen, devils, that their job is to misguide you. You know, the straight path go this way, but there some people are here, or some devils are here. They all tell you, come here, go this way. It's wrong. You need to be focused and go straight to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How to be focused is to be always connected with Him. Recite Surah Al-Fatiha, pray to Him. That's why, how many times we recite Surah Al-Fatiha? Once a day?
No.
In each single rak'ah in our salah, how many salah we have every day?
Five.
How many prayers? Five. Fajr, Dhuhr, Asr, Maghrib, and Isha. That's the minimum, right? Those are the obligations. Then you can do extra. In each single rak'ah of the salah, you're supposed to recite Surah Al-Fatiha. Why? Because you really need guidance. We need to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for guidance to show us the right way, to show us the right track, and to keep us on the right track. Sirat, which track? Sirat al-lazina an'amta alayhim, the track, the way of the good people, the people that you favored, the people that you showed them the right way, an'amta alayhim, you blessed them, the way of the people who were blessed, like all the prophets. Prophet Noah, peace be upon him, Adam, Muhammad, Ibrahim, alayhim as-salam, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's peace be upon all of them. Say ameen. Those were guided, those were kind. Prophet Isa alayhi salam and all the other prophets, right? This is the right way. We need to go with those prophets, with the followers of those prophets. Not غير المغضوب عليهم, not the wrong track, the track of the wrong people. مغضوب عليهم, those who, they knew the truth. They knew this is the right way, but they decided to take other ways. And instead of going from A to B, they went from A to C, even though they know it's not going to take them to A. Allah called them مغضوب عليهم. Allah is angry with them. Because like if your mom tells you, do that, and you know that your mom wants you to do that, but you insist to do the opposite, she's going to be what?
Mad
at you. Because I told you, you know what do I want, and it's good, it's not bad, and it's actually for you. Now you decide to go the wrong way, she's going to be angry at you. That's exactly what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He called them al-maghdubi alayhim, not the track of those who you are angry with them. Because they know the truth. They know this is the right way, but they decided not to go this way. وَلَا الضَّالِّينَ, the people that you ask your question about, those who went wrong. They didn't know that they went wrong, or they are going the wrong way. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala always keep reminding us. He gives us a day after day. He gives you an entire life. You're going to live for years and years just to figure out what is the right way. He gives you the Quran and He gives you the prophets to tell you the right way to go. So all we need to do is go this way. There's no time for your question. I'm sorry, Abdullah. We're going to take more questions later. But let's recite Surah Al-Fatiha very quickly and conclude by that. After we finish all of that, we say Ameen in prayer, which means, O God, O Allah, respond to us. Yes, Noor. Yes, we'll play after that, and we, inshallah, get all the hasanat and all the good deeds. Let's recite. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim.
Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim.
Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen.
Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen.
Ar-Rahmanir Rahim.
الرحمن الرحيم
مالك يوم الدين
مالك يوم الدين
إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين.
إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين.
اهدنا الصراط المستقيم.
اهدنا الصراط المستقيم.
صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم.
صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم
غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين.
غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين.
أحسنتم. Good job. MashaAllah. We finished Suratul Fatiha. And I do thank all of you guys, mashallah. And I thank all of my viewers. Until we see you next time. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
If you're looking for a book to read that's going to give you what you need, the Quran is like a light. The readers, they shine so bright. It shows us the way to go. Before it, we did not know. When you put it in your heart, I think you're going to say,
I love the Quran.
First you got to read it, then you understand it, then you want to say,
I love the Quran.
When you understand it, then you got to do it, then you want to say,
I love the Quran.
When you do it, you will be rewarded, then you want to say,
I love the Quran.
But first you got to read it, then you understand it, then you want to say,
I love the Quran.